Hey, what's up, everybody, and welcome to another episode of News Dose, where I give you all the latest news in the game industry. And today will be a shorter episode than usual because I'm only going to be focusing on two different topics. I actually don't even usually do News Dose on Saturdays, and I think this may be my first time ever. I mean, I usually focus on top 10 lists during the weekend, but I thought these two topics were important enough to discuss before Monday. The two topics in specific we're going to discuss today is Xbox is supporting cross-generation games for the Xbox Series X and Xbox One, and also PlayStation is yet again rumored to not be at E3 this year. Okay, so first we're going to talk about Xbox because I feel like a lot of people are kind of making this a bigger deal than it actually is. In fact, it really feels like console wars is taking over the narrative by this point, or at least in the last week. You had that PlayStation logo thing earlier this week, and while it was a weird announcement, it wasn't really a big deal one way or the other. Then you have this cross-generation announcement for Xbox, as well as the PlayStation being absent at E3, and this really is just the beginning of console wars becoming really chaotic over the next year heading into next generation. Regardless though, yes, Xbox first-party head Matt Booty revealed that they will be supporting Xbox One alongside Xbox Series X for the next few years, and what that means is they will be releasing their first-party games such as Halo Infinite as cross-generation games. I always thought this was kind of already known just because Phil Spencer has kind of hinted at it for a long time with his statement, "No consoles left behind," but really it seems like it's just a transitional period. So in 2021, at some point, it's very likely that games start to no longer support Xbox One, but up until then, you're going to see first-party games available on both Xbox One and Xbox Series X. Well, I've kind of seen people make this into a really big deal over the last day, and I think it's very console warrior driven. I've seen people make claims that games would be held back graphically because of this, and I've also seen people say, well, why do you even need to buy Xbox Series X then? Starting out, games scaling up and down is not a new thing, so you don't have to worry about games being held back. PC gamers in specific are very used to this, and I'm going to use the example of both Gears 5 and Sea of Thieves, which looks and runs much better on PC than they do on Xbox One X. I actually play both of those games on PC because of this, and I do have Xbox One X as well, which is a phenomenal console. They just look much, much better on PC, especially under max settings. The reason as to why is because scaling and frame rate. The way you make a game look much better on PC is through better textures, lighting, shadows, frame rate, better anti-aliasing methods, and the list goes on and on. And the biggest upgrade going forward with Xbox Series X is going to be those exact things, especially frame rate and lighting, thanks to significantly better processors and ray tracing. So why would you buy Xbox Series X during this transitional period if you already have Xbox One? Well, that is completely up to you. You have that choice. It would be the exact reason PC gamers buy the best of the best gaming rigs and spend thousands of dollars because they want the best visual experience. So if you want to run games like Halo Infinite at the best it could possibly look on consoles, the highest frame rate and so on and so forth, you would want to buy Xbox Series X. If you, however, are okay with the more budget option and don't mind lower frame rate, you don't mind lower textures, lighting, etc., then you can certainly buy it on Xbox One. There's nobody stopping you. Microsoft is okay with that. Their main goal is for you to play their games, and they don't really care where you play it. That's why they're giving you options. You can play on Xbox Series X, PC, Xbox One, or even Game Pass. They also have xCloud on the way, which is going to be available on phones. They just want you in their ecosystem as their software, as well as services like Xbox Game Pass and Xbox Live, is where they're making most of their money. But it has been interesting to see some of the reactions about Xbox supporting cross-generation titles for this transitional period because it isn't anything new. PlayStation boss Jim Ryan even made a statement last year which indicated that they too were going to support PlayStation 4 with cross-generation games. In an interview with CNET, this was his exact quote, "Whether it's backwards compatibility or the possibility of cross-generational play, we'll be able to transition that community to next generation. It won't be a binary choice about whether you have to either on PlayStation 4 or next gen to continue your friendship." So in this quote, it does appear they will have cross-generation titles as well, though to what extent we don't really know just yet. But even looking at previous generations, especially with third-party titles, you do see a lot of cross-generation games, and oftentimes they're ignored because the hardcore gaming community wants to play those games at the best visual quality. That is one of the reasons that people like to buy new consoles. Games such as Zelda Twilight Princess and Zelda Breath of the Wild were both cross-generation titles. Then you had Titanfall, which was available on Xbox One and Xbox 360. There is actually a lot of other games as well. This is both because of a business decision, because, you know, they want to include those 100 million people that already have a console. You know, PlayStation, they've sold 106 million consoles, or in Xbox's case, they've sold around 45 to 50 million. You know, they want to include those people. As well, they're also being pro-consumer, so I just don't see this as a negative thing. Now moving on, we're going to focus on PlayStation because there is a rumor that they may be skipping out on E3 for the second year in a row, but instead they're going to be focusing on their own events. The thing is, I understand this from a business perspective because E3 is really expensive, and honestly we don't really need this type of event the same way we did years ago, because you can just release a video and get basically the same coverage as long as you prepare people in advance. Sure, it is disappointing because for me, E3 is like a gaming holiday where you get to see all of these big games from everybody. You have Microsoft, Nintendo there, you have Sony, EA, Ubisoft, and you get the point. There's a lot of different companies that shows up at E3. Everybody comes and releases all their big news, and it's just incredibly exciting. So if PlayStation skips out on E3, it's less exciting than what it would have been before because they are a big part of E3, but nonetheless, I don't think that this is a major deal either. It's like I said earlier, I think people are kind of making things into a bigger deal than they actually are, and I think a lot of that is because of console warring, you have concern trolling, and this, that, and the other. I just don't see it as these big negatives that some of the other people are going to say that they are. Anyways though, I just wanted to talk about my thought process about these two topics, but I would love to hear your opinions as well, so let me know in the comments below, and if you liked the video, don't forget to hit that bell notification and subscribe button. Peace out!